The Catholic Channel, SiriusXM 129 presents Sounds from the Spires with Dr. Jennifer Pasquale, Music Director of St. Patrick's Cathedral.
Hello and welcome to Sounds from the Spires. This is Dr. Jennifer Pasquale, and today we have a very special treat. We have two guests today, one live in the studio and one in Boston. Here live with us here in New York City is Richard Clark. He's been on our show before. He's a wonderful organist, composer, liturgical musician, and overall musician, great person. So, hi, Richard.
Hey, Jennifer. It's great to see you. Thanks
you
for having me here.
Thanks.
It's always fun. It's always a good time talking to you.
Right. And Richard and his other friend, Richard Kelly, who is in Boston. Hi, Richard.
Hello. Good morning. Afternoon.
Good afternoon. Well, it depends on what time people listen by the time this airs. So, thanks for being with us today. And it's really a great treat to have you here with us. And Richard is a trumpet player, fantastic trumpet player, musician, and he currently plays with the Boston Pops, and he's been a soloist with the Boston Symphony Orchestra, so big gigs. And so we have Richard and Richard with us today.
This is going to get very confusing.
I know. Maybe we should go Clark and Kelly. How do you,
what do you think? We need code names.
We'll go organ Richard, trumpet Richard. How about that?
Sure.
Yeah, let's do it.
All right. So organ Richard and trumpet Richard, both from Boston, are going to be performing at St. Patrick's Cathedral on Thursday, November 2, in a concert which is appropriate for All Souls Day. And they're going to be featuring works of Hovhannes Pinkham Clark, Richard Clark, the organist, and Sowerby. So the featured work is going to be Richard's Requiem for an American in Paris. So that'll be really wonderful for All Souls Day for the to remember the faithful departed. So, Richard Organ and Richard Trumpet, that's Richard Clark and Richard Kelly. How did you two meet and come together to start your organ and trumpet duo playing?
I think we met through a mutual friend, Barbara LaRonga, who's a trumpet player. We love her. She's out in California now. And Rich Kelly had just moved back from New York. And she said, if you need another trumpet player, I got this guy. She brought him along. I'd been playing with her for a while. And it might have been a wedding, maybe it was Christmas or something. There, we did some basic gig that was nothing incredible, special. But I just remember I have a memory of playing. I think it might have been the Mendelssohn Wedding March for a wedding, and I kind of looked at it, and there was a chemistry going on. It was like one of the most fun weddings I'd ever played, and we kind of looked at each other and like, whoa, we gotta play together more. I don't know. That's my memory, Rich. I don't know. What do you recall?
It was either that or it might have been a Christmas thing pops to mind as well.
Yeah.
And it might have been that I made up a descant or something like that. But it whatever it was the same kind of thing. I had so much fun, and you were so chill, different from most, you know, some organists I've worked with or that kind of
uptight.
Yeah.
That kind of thing where it could have been really stressful, and you were so funny and so cool and played so great, and you were like, you gave me carte blanche. You were just like, no, that sounds great.
That's the wise thing to do with Rich. I mean, I think this was the late 90s. Is that right? Does that sound right?
I think so.
Yeah, so we've been playing together for, it's about 20 years now. But, I mean, the funny thing is, when I give Rich some arrangements, and Christmas is a good example, and Rich is an amazing improviser. That's another level that is really interesting. So I'll give him, you know, some arrangements. Okay, verse one, this, two, layout, three, this, whatever. Verse four, throw the music out. I write on the score, go to town. and just amaze people. And you'll have people up there snaring. And it's his ability to improvise, his creative ability is phenomenal. So I think that was a spark. That we both have that sort of improvisational creativity that we're like, we got to keep doing this.
Yeah, wow, that's fantastic. So, Richard Kelly, are you originally from Boston?
I am, yes, from Jamaica Plain.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And Richard Clark is originally from New York, right?
I'm originally from New York, yeah. I was born in St. Vincent's Hospital, grew up in Long Island. And I lived in Jamaica Plain for a long time. Great town in Boston, phenomenal place.
Right.
But I work at St. Cecilia Parish right in Boston. It's right down the block from Boston Symphony Hall, and a couple of blocks away from Fenway Park. And it's a very cool part of town. It's right behind the Berklee College of Music, so it's very dense with musicians.
Yeah. Yeah, so Richard Kelly, you probably play a lot of weddings at Richard Clark's church, huh?
I do. Yeah, and it's like falling off a log. It's you feel like you're home.
Yeah, that's
so
great.
Fun and easy.
It's great to have that camaraderie and that friendship where you just make music together and come so naturally.
For sure.
Yeah. And Richard Clark had put together a whole bunch of tracks for us today, and we'll get to sample some of them, which is wonderful, and hear you guys play together. Maybe let's listen to one right now. This is the Philip Telemann Air de Trompette. The Philip Telemann Air de Trompette, played by our two guests today, Richard Kelly on trumpet and Richard Clark on organ, and that was at St. Cecilia's Parish in Boston.
Sure, yeah, right there, and that's just part of our wedding demo CD, so you get married there, you've got a real good shot of getting Rich Kelly to play for you, and I say, listen, he's worth every penny, this is a steal, you want to pay him.
Yeah, great. Yeah, it's fantastic sound, great playing, I love brass, I used to be a French horn player as an amateur, but yeah, I stopped.
Wow.
It's still sitting in my basement, but it's, you know, one of those things, organ one. So Richard Kelly, I mean, you play with the Boston Symphony Orchestra and the Boston Pops, I mean, what is that like? There's such huge organizations, well known, you've played with Bocelli and James Taylor. What is that like?
Very exciting and oddly very, you know, human. It's nice to be that close to people that you're starstruck with and have grown up listening to and seeing. And, you know, it's so funny to every now and then be standing outside and realize I'm having a conversation with Keith Lockhart, just chatting. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Okay. pretty much everyone you meet is so down to earth, and it's a nice reminder that everyone is human and, you know, just basically a good person.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, so it's nice to break down that barrier, and I realize that that's a really wonderful thing that I get to do. I mean, I think so few people would get to have that kind of an experience. I feel really blessed to see that, and helps my perspective in life and all the rest of it, and the music making just is that much more fun.
Right. Yeah, that's fantastic. And, you know, I understand the life of a church musician and, you know, liturgy, organ, masses, and blah, blah, blah. But as a trumpet player, what is your average day like? Or is there an average day?
Yeah, no, not really. That's a very good point. And it depends on what's going on. Like recently, it's been a little more quiet, and that's actually been a good thing. I you know, took some time off from some things, and where it was the year before, I think I took every gig I could possibly take and never stopped moving. And
uh-huh.
I think you have to go through those you know, those cycles of up and down and resting and taking care of yourself and personal life and home and bills and all the rest of it. But I guess there's really never a completely normal day. It's like today I'm picking up my girls from school, uh-huh. and you know, that kind of thing. But since Rich and I have a rather big concert coming up, a lot of my days are practicing and putting that time in.
Yeah.
Whether Rich and I are together or just by ourselves individually. So, yeah, depending on what's going, and I have other things coming up where I'll be flying to Michigan and, you know, possibly doing some singing and some playing. And so you always have something to work on, which is actually really motivating and great. So it's never dull, even if you're not out at a gig.
Right.
You kind of always have something to do.
So you're also a singer, Richard?
Yeah, I've been singing more as time has gone on. It's something I've always done.
Rich can sing.
Here and there,
he's modest.
But I've been enjoying it a lot and starting to take some lessons and things like that. And if I can plug my vocal teacher, Pam Wolf, who is soprano extraordinaire and teacher extraordinaire at Brandeis University and wife of Larry Wolf, the principal bassist of the BSO, and is just, she's amazing.
Wow.
And it's been nothing but fun and positive.
Right. Well, you have excellent breath support already, so.
Yes. Thank you.
Yeah. And the Alan Hofhannes piece, I guess that requires a lot of breath support because there are some really long phrases in that prayer of St. Gregory. I believe his full name is Alan Hofhannes Chakmagian, and really beautiful piece, a prayer of St. Gregory, who is the saint known for Gregorian chant. He did not invent Gregorian chant, but he, you know, he started compiling it a thousand years ago.
And interestingly, he lived in Somerville, Massachusetts, and in Arlington, Massachusetts.
Hofhannes.
He's another New Englander. Actually, at the concert we're performing, it's all American composers, but three out of four of us are New England-based. Daniel Pinkham, Hofhannes, and myself, although I'm probably rejected as a New Englander given my baseball allegiance. We won't talk about that.
Right. Yeah. So we'll take a listen now to Prayer of St. Gregory.
Thank you.
that's Daniel Pinkham, Scenes from 2006, the fourth movement, A Time to Dance, which is from Ecclesiastes 3. And our guests today, Richard Clark on organ and Richard Kelly on trumpet, played that, performed that. It's a wonderful piece. And you said, Richard, that this was written for Richard Kelly?
Yeah. In 2006, we were hosting an event for the American Guild of Organists, and I had been friends for a long time with Dan Pinkham. And I had asked him, I said, you know, I got this amazing trumpet player. Can you write a piece for him? Told him all about Rich, told him all the things that he could do. He could do much of the rest of the piece, too, is not as idiomatic for trumpet. Rich will attest, I've got the easy parts. He's got, he asks the trumpet to do things that you're not going to ask a trumpet player ordinarily to do. And he does them so beautifully. There's so many different colors on that. But that's the closing movement. So I asked him, I said, we will pay you all of the money we have in our offshore and Swiss bank accounts. And he agreed to those terms, which was very generous. The other thing that was going on was I didn't realize Dan was dying at the time.
Oh.
And he passed away at the end of 2006. Mm. He had cancer, and, you know, we kept bass and, you know, he's been lifelong friends with James David Christie, who I studied mm-hmm. with, and that's how our connection is. And I saw Jim one day, and he's just looking really down and sad. We realized that he'd taken a turn for the worse, but he made it through the rehearsals on this. Always had his sense of humor. And when you get to experience the entire work, it's pretty profound to see this is what someone who was contemplating his own mortality, perhaps, among other things, yet still had a time to write A Time for Joy mm-hmm. and brought so much joy to people. And he said to me later about Rich Kelly, he said, he was everything you said he was and way more. I said, well, yeah, that's right.
Yeah, yeah, those sound like some really hard trumpet parts. And if you want to hear the whole work, you can hear it on November 2. That's a Thursday night here in New York City at St. Patrick's Cathedral. It is a free concert for All Souls Day, and you'll hear the entire Scenes, Daniel Pinkham, four movements, including other works on the program. So 7 o'clock on Thursday night, November 2, All Souls Day. Richard Kelly and Richard Clark in concert at St. Patrick's Cathedral. Come on out and listen to both of them. They're fantastic musicians. And before the break, we were listening to Prayer of St. Gregory of Hovhannes, and just that dynamic control there at the very end of the piece, Richard Kelly, was just amazing. It's just mind-blowing. How you can go from total forte to this nice pianissimo.
He makes it sound easy, but it's the sympathetic vibrations that he does with the pipe organ, and every little bit of nuance that you put into it pays off.
Right. And here's a line that was mostly written by Brian McCreath
yeah.
of the BSO. He wrote, "The career of trumpeter Richard Kelly is not only a testament to the versatility of his instrument, but also to the ability of one individual to excel across the broadest possible range of music." How true.
That is so true. I've had a front row seat to that for years, so amen to that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Great stuff.
Yeah.
And the featured work on this concert is going to be because it's All Souls Day, the Requiem for an American in Paris. And Richard Clark, you wrote this. What was the impetus behind this work?
A couple of things. It's dedicated to the memory of someone very near and dear to our family, Anita Cipriani, who is actually not a blood relation, but when you're if your parents were immigrants and you grew up in New York City, as my mother did and she did, your family is in across the ocean in the 1920s and 30s, et cetera, and you're stuck with the between the you know, the World War II and the Depression, you didn't travel far. And this is someone who became a godmother and an aunt to all of us. And I think she introduced my parents, got them together. So I'm here today because of her. And she was a French teacher, spent probably a third of her life in France. And she was she was honored by the French consulate here in New York. And also around the same time, Gregorian chant has always been an obsession of mine. And I think I really had my first real experience of the Mass in the extraordinary form and between the two. And coming out of that, one day I said, I know the next piece I'm going to write. It will be a piece for organ and trumpet. I'm writing this for Rich Kelly, and it's going to be based on the Gregorian chants of the Requiem Mass. And the other thing about Rich, which I've mentioned, is he, as I said about Dan Pinkham, he wrote things that are not idiomatic of the trumpet, not things you expect to hear out of a trumpet necessarily. Rich does some things that very few other trumpet players can do, and that is a true lyricism. He's able to sing. He his tone can get a darkness and a warmth to it. Has a truly tremendous dynamic range. You would not associate Gregorian chant with the trumpet, but with Richard Kelly, it is a natural fit. And I just took the ball and ran with it. And we've gotten to perform this a few times. And although it's a requiem, and I poured out a lot of grief in composing the piece, the two of us have a little way too much fun performing it.
Yeah, I noticed that your Dies Irae happens to be on a little bit happier side than your normal.
Yeah, I was told that recently. one of the editors at WLP, Alan Hammerding, said this one's the award for the happiest. Happiest Dies Irae, and I said, well, either it is, or you are as messed up as we are. I don't know. It's good. But we do have too much fun playing.
No, it's important to have that good camaraderie and enjoy the music that you're performing. So let's hear the introit from Richard Clark's Requiem for an American in Paris.
Thank you.
And that is the Introit movement, based on the Requiem Aeternam chant, from Richard Clark's Requiem for an American in Paris. And both Richard Clark, the composer and organist, and Richard Kelly, trumpet player, are both performing the entire work in concert on November 2 at St. Patrick's Cathedral. That's Thursday, November 2 at 7 o'clock p.m. It's a free concert. Please come on out if you're in town. It's going to be a great concert. So Richard Clark's Requiem, Hofhannes. What else are we doing?
Sowerby,
yes, yeah. And Pinkham. So it's going to be a great concert.
Yeah, it's going to be fun.
Yeah. And it's great. You love chant, Richard, and you write so much stuff. And even I'm doing this workshop this coming weekend where I'm going to be showcasing some of your communion antiphons, which is great. And
great,
they're all
thanks.
Chant-based and...
Yeah, that's a whole other part of my life that I say, you know, it reduces stress and anxiety. I've written so many of these liturgical pieces, and in this case, a lot of works. I've actually finished the entire liturgical cycle.
Wow. How do you have time? You have four children.
You have to do it. If I don't compose, I die inside. So I find a way to do it. I also say it reduces stress and anxiety, and since I'm so riddled with anxiety, it's clearly I produce a lot. So it's... I don't know. You know, when it has to be done, when something comes in your brain, you got to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. You find a way.
Yeah, just very creative, yeah. And just get those juices flowing and put it on paper and, share it with the world. So I think by the time people listen to this, that it'll be too late to advertise that workshop. But Richard, you can find Richard's Communion Antiphons on, it's WLP, correct?
Yeah, yeah. World Library Publications, WLP.com. Mm-hmm. Right now they have four collections for the Easter season, for Christmas season, and also Advent and Lent.
Mm-hmm.
And those are out. And at some point we'll be making available the rest of the year, one way or the other. So,
yeah, congratulations. That's a lot of work for three cycles. I mean, ABC?
No, it doesn't. The Communion Antiphons, particularly in Ordinary Time, there's actually, doesn't go according to the cycles. You can even see in the rubrics, there's two per Sunday. And generally one of them is consistent with, is usually often from a psalm setting, and the other may be from one of the Gospels. But the wonderful thing about the Communion Antiphons is they almost always point back to the Gospels much of the time, mm-hmm. particularly during the other various seasons of the year, and usually one of the two during Ordinary Time often does.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. Check it out at WLPmusic.com, or I think it's WLP or J.S. Pollock, whatever the website is.
And you can find it. Just Google
Richard J. Clark.
And I don't know, mess of stuff will show up.
But your official website is rjccecilia.com, right?
rjccecilia.music.com.
rjccecilia.music.com. And you can find his Communion Antiphons and more about Richard Clark
and
there.
The YouTube channel is the same thing, RJC, Cecilia Music, and you'll hear a lot of stuff that Rich Kelly and I have done on that YouTube channel.
Yeah. So November 2 here in New York, All Souls Day, in concert, Richard Clark and Richard Kelly at 7 o'clock p.m. at St. Patrick's Cathedral. So, Richard, why is your Dies Irae on the happy side?
I don't know. I don't know. It's who knows? I think one of the things is the person that it was written for, Anita.
Okay.
Anita was such a joyous person. She brought us so much life, and she still does. We're still laughing this morning. I saw my mother this morning, and we were laughing about, you know, we've got these Mickey Mouse mugs left over, and I'm drinking coffee out of her Mickey Mouse mug, and how my daughter Adeline has grabbed all her old various stuffed animals that she had, and it's just she was such a joyful person, and mm-hmm. that has a lot to do with it.
That's a nice story. Yeah, so let's listen to a little bit of the sequence. This is the Dies Irae from Richard Clark's Requiem for an American in Paris.
Thank you.
that is Jubilees from the Requiem for an American in Paris, written by Richard Clark, one of our guests today. He is the organist, and Richard Kelly is the trumpet player on that. And they are performing that live, the entire work, in concert at St. Patrick's Cathedral on November 2. That's a Thursday night, All Souls Day, 7 o'clock p.m. It's free and open to the public, so come on out to St. Patrick's Cathedral, New York. And that's kind of an unusual movement for a requiem. It's upbeat, it's joyful, and it's really more like Vatican II, celebratory, rather than
Well, that's the thing, is the texts of the of so much in the Gregorian chant, even the Dies Irae, there's so much hope in them.
Yeah.
The Jubilees actually is a reference to the Alleluia, where you sing the Alleluia, and then the Jubilees is an elaboration on the end of it. And the Alleluia, of course, was not sung in a Requiem Mass until Vatican II. It does quote some of the tract. In that, in the pedal, and the trumpet quotes the tract as well, Absolve Me, which is an obvious part. So that's in there as well.
Yeah.
And Rich plays, I don't know what it's like for a trumpet player to be playing Gregorian chant. You could ask him.
Yeah, it's just, you know, you play fast, you play slow, you play really well either way. It's fantastic playing, Richard Kelly.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
I'm so glad that Rich Clark decided to write this and share this with me and talk about something I don't think I ever would have been exposed to or had this much knowledge about or love for if it hadn't been for you. So thank you, my friend, and thank you for teaching me.
Yeah, I don't know what to say about that, but thank you. I mean Rich and I have we know each other not only well personally, we know each other musically, and he'll tell you this is something that I would never have been exposed to, but for me, I knew this would, he'd be a natural at this.
Richard Kelly, how many trumpets do you own?
Someone just asked me that a couple of days ago, and my answer is a truthful one. I'm not sure.
You're not sure.
But
that's the right number.
I'm somewhere around 10 or 12, and
wow.
I think I'm fairly tame as far as trumpet players go.
Huh.
I kind of have one of everything that I need, and very few doubles, if you will. And I think a lot of people are enthusiasts and have more of one of the same thing because it has slightly different qualities or that kind of thing. And I don't find myself having that much extra money around. So so I stick to what I need.
Yeah. Do you find yourself having special ones like, say Carnegie Hall, or the ones that are less special that you use outdoors if it's raining or something?
There is one maybe old student model that I have, or if I thought it was going to be, really adverse conditions, I might think about it. But for the most part, I take it with me and just play it. We're a little different than, say, oboists or clarinetists and certainly string players, where, you don't want to bring in an expensive violin in the sun because the resin will melt and all the rest of it. So, we're basically glorified plumbing, so it's hard to hurt us, so that's a good thing.
That's so funny. Funny way to see it. Yeah?
And you get to watch Rich even change trumpets in the middle of a piece, too. So if you're paying attention during the Dies Irae, just before the Lacrimosa, Rich will quickly pick up, put down the C trumpet, pull up the B flat, just because he liked the way it sounded better on that spot.
Yeah.
That's what he does.
Nice. Do you play a lot of natural trumpet, Richard?
I don't. I have friends that do, but I have actually never played one. I mean, I've played around with one for fun, but I haven't taken that plunge. A whole lot of piccolo trumpet and all the regular trumpets and cornets and flugelhorns and those kinds of things. But, yeah, nothing on the natural side of things.
Here's a hard question. Who's your favorite composer?
Ooh, that is a hard question. One of my favorites that I will always love, just because growing up I started playing with the Youth Chamber Orchestra in the prep division of New England Conservatory. Ben Zander was conducting at the time, but one of the first pieces we ever did in my orchestral life was Brahms' Symphony No. 4, and it still stuck with me to this day. That and Beethoven 3, Eroica, and I can safely say I still have both of those symphonies memorized.
Wow.
And it just made that much of an impact to me, and I will never, ever forget them.
Right. That's fantastic. I mean, you have this glorious career. You've played everywhere. You travel around the world, and you've played with all these major orchestras. I mean, what do you see yourself doing 20, 25 years from now? Continue what you're doing? I mean, you got a fantastic career already.
Oh, thank you very much. And I think one of the great things has been the diversity. I've gotten to play you know, some jazz things, and I, as being one of those with perfect pitch, and it's easy to steal and assimilate, if you will, all kinds of things. So I've gotten to play rock and jazz and classical and solo and commercial work, and that's where some of the singing first came in, and in funk bands and things like that. So, you know, in addition to church choirs. So I think the diversity is kind of a big part of my life. I think that's maybe an orchestra career might have not been it for me, even though I really wanted that at some point. But I think things happen for a reason, and I think the diversity in my life has been a great thing. And I'm not sure what I want to do, which is a funny thing to say at 50 years old, but I'm still not sure of what that niche would be, but... right now, I feel like I'm kind of, I think I'm living it.
That's great. As long as you enjoy it, yeah.
Yeah.
It keeps life exciting doing different things.
That diversity that Rich has, that's one of the reasons why he's so astonishing to listen to in whatever particular thing we're doing at any given time. And the other thing I just want to say about it, too, is Rich's personality comes through in his playing. As a personal friend who's known him for really well for 20 years, we've seen each other in some good times and some dark times, and the beauty of his heart. He's a beautiful human being. I'm not making him out to be a saint because we are both horrible sinners. Are we? Can we agree on that?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, yeah. No, we're both we're both huge big time sinners. But he has he's an incredible human being, and that comes out in his playing.
Yeah.
You're gonna hear that.
Yeah. So come on out November 2, Thursday night. That's All Souls Night, 7 o'clock p.m., a free concert at St. Patrick's Cathedral, New York City. Richard Clark, organist and composer, and Richard Kelly on trumpet. They'll be presenting a program for All Souls Day, and a lot of the things you heard today will be played in full on Thursday, November 2. Thank you, Richard Kelly. Thank you, Richard Clark, for being with us today. And we'll see you at St. Patrick's on November 2 at 7 o'clock p.m.
Thank you
so much for sharing your talents and your music. And stay tuned next week for Sounds from the Spires on the Catholic Channel on Sirius XM 129. Thank you to Michael and to Blaze.